Okay, so this video is for the 12th house Mercury video. And I'm gonna be looking down at my notes a lot. You might see me put my glasses on and off, so just bear with me. And excuse my background. A little messy. Okay, there we go. All right. So, here we go. So first we're gonna start with Mercury. Mercury is like your communication style. It's how you think, it's how you speak, it's how you write. Just how you would convey anything, the way you would try to convey a message to another person, that's your Mercury style. It's how you learn. And it's just your overall mind, your analytical, logical mind. I believe the conscious mind, we would call it. And the 12th house is about the unconscious mind. It's foreign, it's nebulous, and it's cloudy. So these two together, I'm not gonna say they don't mix, but it's a strange pairing, because like I just said, you got the conscious coming into the unconscious. So it is a bit of a strange pairing. So let's get started. The first thing is, okay, so the first trait and the most obvious I would say is that they have cloudy communication. Think cloudy 12th house Mercury communication. So what this means is that these people are, and I'm speaking from experience because I have not only 12th house Mercury, but I have 12th house stellium. These people are all the time zoned out. They're in a trance, they're in a daze, they're not paying attention. These are just the people that you're talking and like you're like, blah, you're saying like really important stuff and you see everyone's listening. You look at them and they're just like, they're zoned out in the space. And I would just say that we cannot help it. It's just how we are. Our mind just zones out all the time. Especially if you're in a setting where someone's speaking about like cold hard facts, like they could be talking for like less than a minute and then slowly, involuntarily, your mind just is like, and all of a sudden you're somewhere else. You're in la la land. Your mind, you were born and your mind is stuck in la la land. It is permanently there and you can't do anything about it. So sorry, I had to fix something. So another thing about this cloudy mindset is that you probably don't notice what's going on around you. And I mean anything. Like, anything that's happening in the immediate environment, you're not paying attention to. And this could go to anything. Like, I will drive the same place every single day. And then someone can say, you know, for like months. And then someone could be like, you know, can you tell me how to get to so-and-so? And it might literally be 5 minutes from my house, and I drive past it every day. And I can't tell you how to get there because I'm not paying attention. I'm not zoned into that. That's a earthly, practical thing. How do I get to the supermarket? How do I go to work? How do I go to McDonald's? Shit like that. And it's like, if you're 12th house Mercury, you're not paying attention to that type of stuff because this is not important to you. So a lot of people can get frustrated with you because people would be like, hey, did you see that girl just slap that guy, you know, while you're riding past? Or did you hear what that person just said? Or did you see that movie preview? Or did you hear that advertisement that came on the radio? Like, you, something will happen and you'll look over and be like, oh, so what do you think about? And they'll be like, what happened? Like, we totally missed it. And the person will be like, how'd you just miss that? But we miss it because we're zoned out. We're not really paying attention. This goes for anything that requires focus, like driving, school, especially if your boss is, if you're having a meeting at work, you can bet if there's a meeting at work, 99.9% chance the person is zoned out. It could be intentional. Excuse my cat. She's crazy. It could be intentional. It's not always intentional, but oh my god, the glare. Okay, so I had to reposition because my cat messed up my lighting, so I had to turn it around. Excuse my apartment's not in the best, you know, condition, but that's not what we're here for. For astrology. So here we go. So where did I leave off? And And so people are going to get frustrated. You're often going to have to repeat yourself when it comes to... You're often going to have to repeat yourself when it comes to people because they simply did not hear, were not paying attention, didn't notice, didn't care enough to just be present in the moment. So a lot of times people get frustrated because you got to constantly, like, snap them back to reality. So you're probably going to have to say what you said multiple times. So if they're not paying attention, then where are they at? If they're not, their mind is not here, then where is it at? It is somewhere far, far away. Like I said, it's in La La Land. They're in their own fantasy dream world, and it's awesome there. And they can imagine anything they want, and they kind of get lost in it. I'm not going to say kind of. They do get lost in it. So that's where they are. Your mind, even though the Mercury is about your conscious mind, it's not so much about imagination and art. The 12th house is about imagination and art. So these people... Especially if they have other placements here, which they probably do. These people, their imagination is crazy. Like, I have, like I said, a stellium, including Mercury. And my imagination since a kid has been just out of this world. And a lot of 12th house people that I know, their imagination is something crazy. They can think of things and come up with things that, in their head, that it's just... It's a fantasy world, but to us, it almost feels real, or it at least produces a real emotions. Just making sure it's still on. To us, it will at least produce real emotions. They could be thinking about anything when you're talking to them. You could be talking about how to get your sales up for the business meeting, and they're going to be imagining them on the cover of... And it could, their imagination is unique to them, but they could be thinking about being on the cover of a magazine, or, and a lot of times they're thinking about doing grandiose things. That is a theme of them, of all 12th house Mercury people. They can imagine themselves doing things that are larger than life, things that they wouldn't necessarily have the confidence to do in real life. They could be imagining about sex. They could be imagining about being in a movie. They could be imagining about being the next president of the United States. Like, they could really be imagining anything. But just know that whatever they're imagining to them is 1,000 times more interesting than whatever you're talking about. And so they're not paying attention. And a lot of times we can even fake, like, because sometimes I'll just be having like a really good daydream or a really good fantasy, and someone will come up and start talking to me about the food at work, and I'll just be like, I'll keep daydreaming, and every once in a blue I'll check and be like, really? So you think I'm listening, but I'm really not. And I don't know, daydreaming is just strong. That's the only way I can put it. Daydreams are very powerful, and they produce real emotion. Especially when I was a kid, when I was younger, I had a problem with it, actually, because I would spend so much time just staring off into space daydreaming, and I would be laughing, and it's almost like you're interacting with your daydream. It's almost like you're lucid dreaming, or you're dreaming but you're awake. You're in your own fantasy world, and it's awesome, and you don't want to get up. And it could be a problem, because if you do this for hours a day, like I used to do, you have to really wake up and be like, I know I'm daydreaming and I'm fantasizing and I'm having fun in my own little daydream world, and that's fine because everybody daydreams. But if you're doing it for hours, you have to realize, like, wow, I really just sat on this couch for 3 hours and stared at the wall. And that is amazing that you can be in a space where there's no creativity, where it's stifling, and you can still let your imagination be free. But it can be a bad thing too, depending on your guys' age. If you ever watch SpongeBob, there's this great SpongeBob episode, and SpongeBob and Patrick are in this box. They buy a 50-inch TV, and they're in a box, and they throw the TV away, but they keep the box, and they both sit in the box. And Squidward keeps walking past their neighbor, and he keeps hearing them. They're in an empty box. They're just sitting in an empty box. And they keep giggling. And he's like, what are they giggling about? So he opens the box and it's just them, and they're sitting there and they're like, like they're laughing, but their eyes are closed. It's like, so he closes the box and he walks away and he hears all this noise. And the point of the story is they were in an empty box, but they were imagining that they were climbing up, I think it was like Mount Everest or something. So the whole theme was imagination. Like, they were able to use their imagination, so they had fun with the box. And then Squidward came in the box and he was waiting for something to happen, but he wasn't using his imagination, so nothing happened, and then he was getting frustrated. And I feel like that is just such a perfect 12th house analogy or story, because it's like you can take nothing and turn it into something just with your imagination. As long as you don't overdo it, it's a great gift. And I feel like a 12th house Mercury will never be bored, because even if what's around you is boring, your mind is never boring. So that's like, if you do it in moderation, I feel like it's a good trait. Someone with a 12th house Mercury, a cubicle job, a boring corporate America job is not going to be good for them, because I've been there, and I swear, you put me in a cubicle and it's gray and the walls are gray and the lighting is fluorescent and there's not that many windows and it's just gray and it's boring and it's bland and it's blah. And I really used to just zone out and be in my own world, and then you snap to 45 minutes later and you realize you haven't done your work. These are people in a job like that who are not going to excel, because they're not going to be able to pay attention, and no one's going to stand over you and make sure you do your work every minute of the day. Because it is really, have you ever seen like narcolepsy? I believe it's called narcolepsy, when people are just awake and then they just pass out and they're asleep and they can't help it. That is how it is to be a 12th house person and a 12th house Mercury. You're there 1 second, and the next second something could trigger you. You could see a soda can, a commercial, you could hear something, and you're just catapulted into fantasy land. And once again, you're not paying attention. It's very hard to help, and it's very hard for those around you, because we can't help it, and so other people get frustrated and they can't really do anything about it either. So it can be difficult having a typical stereotypical job or a stereotypical life. Might not necessarily be for you. And if you do choose that path, I guarantee it will be pretty difficult. Another trait about 12th house Mercury is that they don't speak much. They may have inhibited speech, and that could be in the form of a literal speech impediment, like they can't speak. Someone with a lisp, someone who has a stuttering problem, someone who has some type of speech impediment, any type of disorder of the mind that would make it hard to communicate. ADD, ADHD to a lesser degree, because you're so, your mind's just everywhere. It's not where it's supposed to be, even though the mind is not supposed to be anywhere, but according to people, you're supposed to be, you know, the rest of the world, you're supposed to be able to pay attention and focus on what's going on around you. They may inhibit their ideas or their intelligence. This is a big trait. They might hold it back. They might not show it. This is an example of just imagine a whole class full of kids, and there's one kid who never really speaks. He never says anything. He's holding his ideas back. Let's say he's 12th house Mercury. He's holding his ideas back, his thoughts, his opinions, everything that everyone else is speaking, he's keeping to himself. So he's not saying much. And Mercury is also about intelligence, so he's probably hiding his intelligence as well. And everyone might overlook this kid, or they might not even know much about this kid. He always seems zoned out when the teacher's talking. He never raises his hand. He never volunteers or wants to, you know, add anything into the conversation. He never speaks in class, and yet this kid might, you know, have straight A pluses. He could be so smart, and this is frustrating for other people. I think especially if you're a teacher, because it's like you may know a certain kid knows a lot and knows the answer, but for some reason he just won't raise his hand. I was like that a lot, and forgive me, because I'm 12th house Mercury, so I'm going to say I a lot throughout this video, but it's not that I'm being self-centered. I'm just giving you personal experience. So when I was a kid and I would be in class, I almost always knew the answer because I considered myself to be very intelligent, but I did not say it. And I just, some sometimes I think if you have a 12th house Mercury, it can be because you are insecure, or you don't feel like that you're that smart, or you don't feel like your ideas and opinions and thoughts, like anyone will care. But it wasn't that for me, and it's not always that. You might just be someone who doesn't readily speak. You know, there's always that one kid who raises their hand for everything. They always gotta, you know, speak for everything. And then there's that one kid who never really does. And that one kid who never really does, if they're a 12th house Mercury, a lot of times they're extremely intelligent. They always know the answer. They're just never gonna raise their hand and say it. So the learning mind is artistic, and they're gonna learn best with pictures and art, and they're gonna learn through feeling, and they're not gonna learn too much through cold hard facts. Not that they can't do it, but it just resonates more. Like, let's say you had a history lecture, for example, and you say, okay, 1962, civil rights movement, blah, 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 blah. And let's just say you're talking about the civil rights movement and you're just speaking facts and the kids are just taking notes. They are gonna zone out. They're probably doodling something. Like, they might look like they're writing, but they're not paying attention to you. However, if you could put pictures of the people and pictures of the events and pictures of the victims, that speaks to their heart, that speaks to their soul. It exponentially, it like, the information goes in here and it just explodes. And so they feel it. And so they learn because they felt it. They learned and they remember about, this is the church bombing in 1960, whatever. It registers with them more because they can feel it, they can see it. But if you don't show them the pictures and you're just doing names and facts and words, their eyes are gonna be here and their mind is gonna be over here, and they're not really gonna be paying attention. So the best way for you to learn is through pictures and music and art and feeling. If you can somehow get a feeling for what you're learning, then I think you can learn pretty well. 12th house is also about secrets. So these people are really, really good at keeping a secret. If you tell them something, they're not gonna blab. These people, they don't readily speak, even when they know the answer, even when they're right, even if it's about something mundane or whatever. These people do not readily open their mouth. And so this can be really good, because if you've ever confided in them, you can bet your bottom dollar that they're not gonna tell, they're not gonna blab. They're like a vault, and you know, any secret that you tell them is safe because they know how to keep their mouth shut. The 12th house also represents things that are foreign. So they might really be into foreign forms of communication and foreign language. I know I want to be a translator. I have 12th house Mercury, and I have some Sagittarius placements that add to the whole foreign theme, but 12th house Mercury, a lot of times, if they don't actively try to learn a foreign language, they can pick it up. Or, you know, it could be a hobby for them. Or they might just be interested in communication methods that are foreign. These might be, you know, just regular people who watch foreign movies, foreign films, listen to foreign music, and maybe they don't understand it, and maybe they just have an appreciation for it. They are really into communicating with foreign things and faraway things. I feel like 12th house Mercury is something you can see in the charts of people who move permanently abroad. Let's just say you have a kid who's 8 and they're from some foreign country and they go to some other foreign country, you know, and where this new country that they're in, let's say they permanently stay there their whole life, this new country that they're in, the language is now their second language. And so I see this a lot, and it represents a lot of the themes of 12th house Mercury, because, you know, if you go to a new country, of course you have to speak, but you're just speaking the basics. You're speaking the mandatory minimum. Where's the bathroom? Where's the supermarket? Basic food, car lingo, whatever. You're not gonna be busting jokes and, you know, having in-depth conversations with people. Your ideas, your thoughts, your opinions, you're gonna keep them to yourself because you feel inhibited, because you don't really know literally how to express it. If it's not a figurative, I don't know how to put my emotions and my thoughts and my feelings into words, it could be somebody who goes to a foreign country and they literally can't speak, or they cannot get across all their, you know, thoughts and opinions and ideas, and so they don't say much. And so it feels very restricting. Sometimes to have the 12th house Mercury feels so restricting because it's like I just have so much to say and I can't say it for, you know, whatever reason. So I see that a lot. People who have to really work on over a lot of time articulating their ideas in their head, because sometimes we just feel and we don't even know what to think in our head, let alone get it out. So to feel, to articulate that in the head, and then to be able to communicate it, and whether that be through shyness and self-confidence, or whether that be through learning a new language, you really have to take the time to learn how to express yourself verbally. One thing these people are very knowledgeable about, and I will put myself in this category, is occult subjects and occult sciences and studies. Since I've been 14, and I'm 23, so I've been studying almost 10 years astrology. I've studied numerology, palmistry, I've studied tarot, astral projection, subconscious mind. Like, these people are learned, or however you say it, learned. Intelligent and well-read on occult subjects. So if you want to get them to start speaking, you can bring it. Like, I won't talk that much, but if someone gets me started on astrology, I'll be like, blah, 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 like, I'll just go on and on and on. So these people are very smart about these type of subjects. And like I said, if you want to get them to talk, you can ask them, hey, you, what's your sign? You into astrology or whatever? And they probably know a lot about the other side. And this could be another reason why they don't speak much, because astrology, numerology, tarot, palm reading, all these things, these are things that are kind of taboo, and it's becoming more mainstream over the years, but it'll never be, I'm not going to say never, we're nowhere near this being just, you know, accepted in society. Like, even when I tell people, when I used to tell people that I was into learning tarot, they'd be like, oh, are you Christian? Do you worship the devil? And I'd be like, of course I'm Christian. I don't worship the devil. It's just, it's tarot. Like, I'm just reading some symbolisms of cards, or I'm just looking at, you know, the moon is a full moon today. So a lot of times us 12th house people, 12th house Mercury people, we might keep our thoughts and opinions to ourselves, because what we do want to speak about and what we do know about is going to be shunned, or it's going to be taboo, or it's going to get a negative response from others. So we just kind of keep it to ourselves. And since I spend so much time learning about astrology, it's like, when you, not that I have nothing else to talk about, but it's my passion. So when you take away my passion, my ability to speak about my passion, there's not too much left. Like, I can talk to you about other things, but what I'm passionate about, I have to keep inside. So that's another 12th house trick. Or symptom, I should say. In keeping with the theme of communicating with faraway things, these people are oftentimes able to communicate with spirits, able to communicate with the other side. Because the 12th house is all about symbolism, and Mercury is the mind, so you're looking for the symbolism of life. So even if you don't hear spirits or see spirits, and you're not, you know, reading off of a Ouija board, let's say, you are receiving messages from the other side, the universe, or guardian angels, or God, or, you know, spirit guides, or whatever you believe is out there. I believe there's all those things out there. And I believe that they send you messages and symbols, and if you're at peace enough, and if you look, or not even if you look, but if you just pay attention to the things that go on in your life, you'll notice these symbols. So you're able to receive messages from the other side, whether it be hear actual voices and you're like a medium and you're communicating things, or to a lesser degree, I think a lot of the more common trait is you just notice the symbolism in life, the symbolism that, you know, the universe and God is sending to you. Maybe if you're going to a school and the school isn't right for you and bad things keep happening, a lot of people might be like, all these bad things keep happening, but you might notice, hey, bad things only happen when I'm on this campus of this school that I can't afford, and that's too far from my house, and blah, blah, blah. And you might start to see how the universe symbolically you might put it together and it might make sense in your head that, hey, maybe the universe is telling me I'm not supposed to be here. And then when you go to the new school, none of that stuff happens and it's all good things. And then you're like, oh, okay, the universe was sending me a message that, you know, just in that example, was not where I needed to be. So you can communicate with the other side really well, and your mind is really open to the messages that they send you. And this can be bad too, because it's not all good things on the other side. I don't quite know about the bad things. I don't really want to know, but your mind is open. So if you're receiving negative messages or negative energy or negative spirits from the other side, there's a lot of training you can do, and there's a lot of people out there that will help you block this. But mostly I think it's good. I think the 12th house gets a bad rap, so I think it's mostly positive things that the universe sent you that you just noticed that I would say 90-95% of the rest of the world wouldn't notice, or they would have a more hard time putting it together, whereas you notice it more quickly. Okay, so the mind is very, very intuitive and perceptive, and the 12th house is about the collective unconscious, so your mind can pick up what's going on. You can walk in a room, you can walk into a scene, let's say you're a detective, you know, you walk into a crime scene, you walk into a meeting at work, you just walk into any environment, and as soon as you come in, your mind just picks up on things that somebody else wouldn't pick up on. Your mind can just block things that someone else wouldn't pick up on. I'm sorry. Your mind can just pick up on things that someone else wouldn't pick up on. The subtleties, the energy in the air. It's like, imagine brain, you know, little magnetic waves going through the air, and you walk in, and maybe you walk into a room full of people, and there's a bunch of, nose is itchy. You walk into a room full of people, and there's a bunch of tension, but nobody else noticed their attention because no one was speaking, no one was screaming, you know. The body language was pretty normal from a quick glance, but it'll be a 12th house Mercury person that will walk in and be like, something's off. Because your mind can feel, your mind can pick up the energy, your intuition is right, it might just be something is off, and only you notice it. And that's fine, because you're usually right, your intuition is usually on point. This can be dangerous because you need to make sure that your thoughts are your own. Your mind can get very overcrowded because it's like a sponge, and it's open and it's intuitive and it's perceptive to everything around it. So if you're on the bus and there's these people talking about this, and then you go to work and there's people talking about this, and you go home and your family talking about this, and it's all these thoughts, and you pick them up and you soak them up like a sponge, and it can be very tiring and draining to you. You might not even know what thoughts are your own thoughts. And that's a very strange statement, and I was thinking about how I can word it better, and I really can't. All I can say is, if you're a 12th house person, then you know what I mean. Sometimes what we feel and what we think isn't even our own. It's what we've picked up from others. And so you really need to retreat. You really need to have peace and quiet so that the mind can come down and rest and recharge, and so you can get back to yourself and get back to your own thoughts. I kind of hate saying this because I feel like it's just such a stereotype, but it's true. The 12th house, let's make sure it's recording. Okay. The 12th house, a major theme about it is drugs. So these people can abuse drugs because the mind, the conscious mind, is trying to go to a nebulous place, and it can't because it's stuck in reality, and it doesn't really like being in reality. It likes to be in La La Land. How do you get to La La Land quickly and efficiently, and a lot of times dangerously? You take drugs. You take mind-altering substances. That's why drugs are called mind-altering substances, and this is right up these people's alley. Like, for the mind to be hazy, for the mind to be in an altered state, a dreamlike state, a fantasy state. Sorry. For the mind to be in a state elevated, high, an unnatural state, a dreamy, a trippy state, because, you know, drugs in the 12th house, this is what the mind almost feels more normal. Like, 12th house Mercury people can almost feel like, okay, now I can think straight when they're on drugs or when they're drinking, because it's a way, like, them, their mind being tripped out is normal for them. So it almost feels normal, and they can abuse it, especially if the mind gets bored. And like I said before, these people got imagination for days, but in the rare events that they get bored or they become unstimulated, if they become unstimulated by their environment, they can abuse drugs. If they're, you know, if they become really bored and their imagination is just like, you know, they're staring at a wall every day for 8 hours, then they could, oops, sorry. They can resort to drugs because they're still trying to get to La La Land, and sometimes they might need a little boost, a little help to get them there. So this is something that they can do to get them out of reality, to get their mind out of reality. Another great thing is that the mind is very easily hypnotized and suggestible. And this can be good because you can put positive suggestions into your mind. It doesn't have to be all negative. It doesn't have to be stupid, like, I've hypnotized you to quack like a duck every time you hear the doorbell. Like, the mind can be, you know, it can be suggested positive things, and it can be hypnotized to do positive things. For example, a lot of people report hypnosis helps them quit smoking. You might have someone who's smoking for 20 years, pack cigarettes a day for 20 years, and they want to quit and they just can't, or they feel like they can't. And then, you know, hypnosis can help people, but everyone's suggestibility is different. There are people who just are so not really, I'm not going to say not for it, but people who are so, their mind is just not as suggestible, either because they believe it's hocus pocus or their just mind is more rooted in reality, and so it might not work for them. But somebody who has a very suggestible mind, who has 12th house, somebody who has a very suggestible mind and who has 12th house, who has 12th house Mercury, their mind is very easily suggestible, and so you can put good things in it, and that can be a very positive trait. These people are extremely reflective and introspective. It would be a good activity for them at the end of each day to sit alone in silence in a room, peacefully, and reflect on their day. Their mind is going to spend a lot of time being reflective and introspective. And if you overdo it, you can live in the past. You can spend so much time analyzing what's happened in your day, you actually become disengaged. Once again, your mind goes somewhere else and you become disengaged from reality. And so you got to be careful not to reflect too much. Like, don't write a whole biography in your diary, 10-page biography every day. Like, sometimes you can have a little quick reflection, but, you know, not all the time. But I mean, this is a good trait, I believe, because a lot of people don't stop and reflect, and they should. I knew a boy one time, and he had a gazillion relationships. Like, I couldn't even count. Like, from, I'm talking about from serious to having children with women to flings, and none of them lasted. And instead of him, and they would all be short, and there would be no gap time, and then he would go on to the next, and the next, and the next. Libra moon. But I was said to him on multiple occasions, I'm like, don't you see that there's something wrong? There's a pattern. You keep going after women, and within a month or two, it ends. And then, like, a week later, you're going after another woman with all your might. And then a week, you know, month or two later, it ends. There's a pattern. There's something going on there that you need to stop. You need to stop going forward and pause for a couple minutes, 10 minutes, and look back and say, okay, am I picking the wrong woman? Am I not waiting enough time before picking the next woman? Or what is the dynamic? What is the common theme? What is the common pattern that I can look back in hindsight and see is going on that you feel is, and look, you know, contributing to the demise of all these relationships. That's, it's, you know, it's a negative pattern going on, but he refused to be introspective. He refused to reflect. He refused to think about it. He felt that that was living in the past, and he just wanted to keep going forward. The problem is with a lot of people, when you keep going forward and you're not looking back to seeing the mistakes that you made in the past, yes, the past, but the past oftentimes repeats itself in the future. So look back, you know, I try to tell them, look back and see what you see. And it could be for 10 minutes you can reflect and learn something about yourself. And that from the past that you learn, you can carry it into having a better future. But not everyone wants to do that. And so when you're a 12th house Mercury, you do that a lot. It can be too much, but it's more than the average person. And so you'll probably have greater insight into yourself, into your life, than others will. Because you stop to look and you stop to pause and think about it at certain checkpoints when you should and when most people don't. These people logically analyze emotional events. And this can lead them into a therapist's office because they want to talk about, I say therapy is perfect for them in so many ways because they want to talk about their experience, they want to analyze, they want to reflect. And yet, like I said before, these people are not open with their thoughts and ideas, and so they're not going to be open with their deepest, you know, opinions and secrets. They're going to want to share that almost in a secret way, and that's kind of what a therapist is, someone who will hold your secrets, hold your thoughts and ideas, and you guys can reflect together. You might see these people reflecting anywhere. If you ever, you're walking through a park, you see somebody, maybe they're smoking a cigarette, maybe they're smoking a hookah pen, maybe they've had a glass of wine in their hand, and they're just on a hammock, on a swing, just sipping, just kind of staring out in the space. Maybe they're smoking something. Just staring out into space. They're reflecting on something or they're analyzing something. And it's so 12th house because it's a solitude, quiet place. It's themselves. And yet at the same time, they might, like I said, have a substance. Doesn't mean they're abusing it either. You know, just to have a cigarette or a little cigar or a little glass of wine or a shot here and there. This might relax their mind and ease them into an easier reflection mode. I would say the number one, I think, best hands down trait about this placement is that these people, like I said, can identify a self-sabotaging behavior better and more quickly than anyone else. Because I feel like a lot of people don't even do it at all. Like, a lot of people just don't get it. And what I mean by self-sabotaging behaviors, a lot of times people think, like, if you're a 12th house person, you do a lot of self-sabotage. And that's not true. We all self-sabotage. All of us know, every single one of us, there's some area in our life, maybe multiple areas, maybe big or small, where we know what the right thing to do is and what the wrong thing to do is. And we don't. You know, we might get a paycheck and know that we have a bill, and we might disregard the bill and buy a new, you know, shirt. Or maybe we know we're not supposed to eat certain things, or maybe we know we're not supposed to cheat on our partner, or, you know, like, it could be big, it could be small. No one just does the right thing that they're supposed to do all the time. Nobody gets their homework and takes it home and does each homework assignment, you know, in order as they should thoroughly, and wakes up 8 o'clock in the morning and goes to makes a healthy breakfast and goes to school and gets their homework and gets straight A's. Because nobody does it. Everyone messes up either in some way, whether you got home, did your homework, and then you went drinking, or maybe you smoked the L before you went to class, or maybe you did your homework 5 seconds before the teacher walked in. Nobody lives their life perfectly in a way that they already know that they should. So with that being said, we all sabotage ourselves, and I just feel like it's human behavior. We cry and we bitch and we moan. Oh, I got an F on a test. Oh, my bank account is at zero. Oh, I didn't finish my homework. Meanwhile, we had all the resources, the time, and the energy to do those things, but we chose to do other things. And that's fine. I do it all the time. But as a 12th house Mercury, you'll be able to really identify where you yourself have messed up and fix it. And so you can really be extremely self-aware and extremely just ahead of people and knowing yourself, because you're not going to make the same mistakes over and over again, because you see it, you realize it, you realize it before most people do, and you don't recommit them. So that's a like the best quality is being able to see where you're fucking up at. These people can be into communication behind the scenes. So publishing, writing books, writing under an alias, maybe even writing like erotic fiction under like a pseudonym, I believe it's called, just, you know, a different name. Publishing, anything where you're able to communicate but you're not out in the forefront. So I feel like writing is huge. Blogs. These are people who probably have blogs and podcasts, or maybe they write for a journal or for a newspaper column or whatever, and you don't even know, because they're sharing their thoughts, they're behind the scenes. Either what they're sharing is very big and you don't know who's behind it, or the person that you know, you don't even know that they're sharing something. A lot of people don't even know that I make astrology videos. I'm very open about it and I say it, but still a lot of people who see me or know me still might not know that. So in a way, I'm communicating about occult subjects behind the scenes, or, you know, not as obviously as you would think. A negative trait of this placement is for sure mental stress and anxiety. 12th house is the house of anxiety disorders, mental disorders, not all of them, but a lot of mental disorders that are anxiety related, stress related. Those are the disorders that are linked to the 12th house. And so because your mind is here, your mind can become very stressed, your mind can have a lot of anxiety, your mind can be overwhelmed by stress. Maybe it's not able to handle stress as well as other people, and that can be a bad thing, you know. Social anxiety and just generalized anxiety is huge, almost as huge as drugs for the 12th house. And there's other positive things that are huge for the 12th house, but anxiety and stress is so big. And because your mind is here, your mind can often be stressed, and your mind, it can be unfortunate if it goes this way. But it doesn't have to, once again, because you have this weakness, but again, you also have this power to be able to identify where you're not doing your best at, and then you can fix that. The voice is probably often soft and soft-spoken, because remember, we're communicating. So the voice is gonna be soft. I really have to force myself. Sorry, I'm stretching. What I'm trying to say is the camera. I often have to force myself to speak up and speak loud, and it is a conscious effort. It takes effort. Like, it drains me in a very minuscule way to have to speak loud. And, you know, if you're ever, like, in a noisy place and you have to, like, you're relaying information to someone or whatever, it takes a lot. We're not loud people. Not with our ideas, not with our thoughts, and not even with the volume. So we might get over-talked a lot. I get over-talked all the time. People always gotta be like, huh? What? Nobody can really hear me. So as I got older and I was so sick of people having to repeat myself, I would have to be like, 2 McChickens, a Big Mac. Like, I had to almost, to me, yell in order to be heard at the normal level that everybody else communicates at. And that's something you gotta work on. And it will come more natural in time. You'll be able to call on it more easily. As I get older, I'm able to be louder when I know I need to be loud. But it's still like, right before I say, I'm like, Big Mac, 2 McChick. Like, I feel like I'm yelling everything. And just imagine if you had to yell everything, whatever yelling is to you. It's very draining. And yet we have to do it because we want to speak up and we want to be heard. Like, their ideas, their thoughts, their opinions were not valued as a child. Like, let's say, you know, and it can be very unintentional. Let's say, you know, your mom and dad are very busy. You're like, Mom, I want to show you this painting that I did in school. Or, Dad, let me tell you about my day. Or whatever. Whatever a child may say. Whatever. Because the 12th house is about our early years, I believe. Our very early years, where we're being conditioned. The years where our mind is most open. Our subconscious mind is most open. About your experience in the womb. And about those few hours before, during, and after. Like your birth. And so it can be in the early years, someone who is just constantly told to be quiet, to sit down, I don't want to hear that right now, okay, we'll talk about it later. Somebody who just felt like maybe as a kid, every time they opened their mouth, that nobody really listened or nobody really cared, or there wasn't really space or a voice or, you know, for them to be heard. And so, yeah, they might had grow up with that feeling, that seed ingrained in them that my ideas aren't important, my thoughts aren't important, what I have to say isn't going to be respected, heard, valued by those I'm speaking to, so I'm just not going to speak and I'm going to keep my thoughts to myself. And so you really have to work through that and work through the mental self-confidence or confidence in your mental abilities, because your opinion and your ideas and what you want to talk about is just as valuable as the next person. It's infinitely, as my teacher told me one time, you are infinitely as important as anyone else here. And I just love that. And your thoughts and your words and everything that you want to say and everything that you think is infinitely as important as anything that anyone else has to say. So don't beat yourself up and don't hold your thoughts in. What makes what you say as a 12th house Mercury person, or as someone, or as anyone who struggles with getting their ideas out, what makes what you say any less valuable than the next person? I mean, if we really stop and analyze, people are talking about Instagram, people are talking about Facebook, people are talking about whatever. A lot of times, the next person over who's talking, you know, from you, isn't really saying anything of substance either. So even if you feel like what you're saying is dumb, so what? Say it. As I've gotten older, especially in the past couple years, I have forced myself. Like, anything that comes to my mind, I'll say it. Like, I make myself say it. It's not always good, but it's building a good muscle for getting your thoughts out there. And I've gotten a positive response. People want to hear what you have to say. People want to hear you talk. That's how they get to know. By speaking, by communicating. Others can get to know you better, and by holding it in, no one does. I remember so vividly, I was on the school bus, and I used to always sit there and not say anything, and I would put my music in, and I would go off into La La Land and stare out the window for an hour, and I loved it. So 12th house, everything I just said about that was 12th house, Mercury. So, but every once in a while, like literally a few times a year, either my iPod, because that's what we had back in the day, my iPod would die, or I would forget my earphones or whatever, and so I would just be sitting on the bus and I would just be like, you know, reality was so boring to me. Sitting on the bus was boring. I couldn't go into La La Land, where, you know, I was in my own fantasy world. I couldn't escape there because my music would take me there. And of course, I didn't do drugs because I was in ninth grade, so I just couldn't get there. If I, you know, if I was on the bus and I didn't have my music, I couldn't get there. And I would just stop and I would listen to the other kids, and sometimes they would say stuff and I would think something in my head, but I wouldn't say it. Like, it could be a joke, it could be a thought. And then somebody else would say the exact word for word what I was just thinking in my head, and everyone would laugh. And I was just thinking to, and it happened a few times, and I would think to myself, Kara, if you would just say what it is that you were thinking, if you would just get your thoughts out there, people could know you better. People could, you know, interact with you better, enjoy you better. You might enjoy others better. You might make a connection. But to all my 12th house people, my 12th house Mercury people, if you don't speak, we can't know what you're thinking. We can't know what's on your mind. We can't connect to you. And who's to say if you don't open your mouth, or if you do open your mouth, you know, somebody might laugh. Somebody might say, oh, I didn't, you know, you might think what you might say is dumb. And so you might make a whole new connection with someone. I was speaking to a friend earlier who I've known for, I mean, I just met her this year, but I've been around her quite a bit. And just in us talking, she told me that she reads. And so then I started to open up about books. But had she never mentioned the and we, you know, we start talking about what books that we read and that we both liked. And now I'm thinking to myself, like, if I read any good books, I'll text her about it. Or if she reads anything, she can suggest it to me. If she had never said, as we were riding past the library, oh, there goes the library, I gotta return some books. And then I would have said, you know, started my conversation. Had she never made that small comment, we would have never made that connection. Yeah, like I said, you have to open your mouth. You have to force yourself. Force. And it feels forced and it feels like effort. But I swear it's a muscle. It takes years to develop, but I feel like I'm developing it pretty well. And as I get older, I just feel more and more comfortable saying my thoughts, my ideas, and I'm getting such a positive response. And it's allowing me to open myself up more, and it's allowing other people to connect with me more. So just work on it. Be patient with yourself. It takes years, it takes time, but you can do it. This could also be someone who gets made fun of by their peers, and that's why they don't want to speak. Maybe they have a lisp. Maybe, you know, whatever language they're speaking is not their native language. Whatever, these people could also have been bullied in their younger years for their speech, or they might feel that they will be bullied for their speech, and so they don't. But you have to push through that, and you have to say what's on your mind, because like I said, it's just as valuable as anything that anyone else has to say. To wrap it up, some final points, just things I've noticed from myself, from other 12th house Mercury people. These people can drift off mid-sentence, mid-story. Like, they can literally be telling a story and they can just be like, yeah, and then so I went to the store and then she, and they could just, they can be lost in their own story and forget where they were going. And so you, as the person listening to it, you'd be like, and you went to the store and it's just, no, like the thought just went poof, like it just disappeared. So mind you, the mind is like a cloud. Where the brain should be, there's literally a cloud nine. Like, they're not here. So, what was I saying? See, I just did. I gotta look at my notes. Yeah, so the mind drifts. It can drift off mid-sentence, mid-story, and it can be when they're communicating or it can be when someone else is communicating. So it's common. If you're telling a story, make sure that you pause constantly and check in with them and be like, so it, you know, just add, be like, just add things in so that they'll have to respond to keep them engaged. And if you are telling a story, just try to stay engaged. I know it's hard. These people are always singing and humming, always. This cat is crazy. These people are always humming a tune because they're in La La Land, and La La Land's not boring, so there's often music. So whatever song is stuck in their head, and they usually have songs stuck in their head. This is a big trait of 12th house Mercury. They usually have music stuck in their head, so they're always gonna be singing it, and it's unconscious. Like, they just, you'll just see them walking around the house humming. In the shower, you might walk past the bathroom, you hear them singing. These people always humming and singing. And another thing, they tell a lot of jokes. These people are extremely funny. People don't give 12th house people the credit for being as funny as they are, because they are always thinking of scenarios and funny things, and they can't quite get it out. They just know that they can laugh at it. If you've ever watched any type of sketch comedy show, I'm gonna use the most famous one I know, Dave Chappelle show. He has an idea for a sketch and then he'll act it out and it'll be funny. And a lot of times the 12th house person, I'll just have random ideas, just like, it's almost as if it's a comedy sketch in my head, and it'll just be funny to me. Sometimes I can't get it out, sometimes I can. But these people are very funny because they can imagine shit and imagine scenarios in ways that other people can't, and they could put a different spin on it, and it'll just be surprising and quirky and fun. But once again, you gotta get the jokes out. You gotta get it from here to here so that people can get it. And sometimes, sadly, they won't. Sometimes I am laughing at something and it is so funny. I've been doing this for years, since I could remember. Since I've been like 10, 11, 12, I could imagine the funniest scenarios. And I just knew, I could see it in my head, and I just knew that if I would explain it with words, it would ruin it and it wouldn't be funny, and or the person wouldn't get it. Or I couldn't paint the picture with words the way I could see it in my mind. That is such a 12th house thing. But I could see it clearly and it was funny. And so a lot of times I would just be, still to this day and probably to the day I die, you're gonna see me sometimes just smiling, laughing, giggling. And I'm not going to tell you what the joke is, because I can't tell you what the joke is. I can just see it. I can just feel it. I know what's funny in my head, but I just can't relay it. Maybe I don't try to relay it. Maybe I don't want to relay it, whatever. But they're really funny. Because you don't talk that much, a lot of people may see you as shady. Because, you know, as humans, we don't really know what to do when we don't understand someone or something. So we might kind of classify it as bad. So the person who sits in the corner and never says much, or maybe they're not sitting in the corner, but the person who never says much, people might see them as shady, as mysterious, and not in a good way. People might see them as cocky, arrogant. People are going to project anything that they want to project onto you because you haven't given them something to work with, because you probably not speaking. So the more you speak, the less people can project and the more they can get to know you for yourself. And my final point is 12th house is the best thing about the 12th house, hands down, and the biggest thing, hands down, is the compassion that it lends you. Now, Mercury isn't an emotional planet by any means, but any 12th house placement can add a huge touch of compassion, and it's infinite, boundless compassion, can add a touch of compassion to your just your general spirit and your aura. You may speak a lot about humanitarian things, helping others. You may speak you may speak about, you know, you might preach compassion, kindness, love, or you just might, you might think about it more, you might feel it more. It's strange because Mercury's not like I said, it's not a feeling planet, but anything in the 12th house would make you more compassionate. So yeah. Oh, and I forgot to add this in. 12th house Mercury, you guys are fantastic listeners. Because you don't feel the need to, you know, just fill the air with mindless talking like everyone else, you know how to shut up and you know how to listen. You guys are the true, or us, you know, we're the true definition of one mouth, two ears. Like, we don't need to always be talking. Doesn't mean our mind's not working. Doesn't mean we're not listening. 12th house Mercury is a great position for someone who's a listener, and this is someone who's going to feel your story. If you come to them and you say, hey, I've had a bad day, or I have a dilemma, they're really going to listen. As they're listening, as they're not talking, they're absorbing in what you're saying. They also feel what you're saying. They feel your pain, they feel your anguish, they feel your confusion, whatever it is that you're relaying, they feel, even if it's positive. But especially if it's negative, because they have this compassionate nature, they're going to listen to you. They're going to feel your story as you're telling it. And because they're so reflective and introspective, they can give great advice. Now, you know, nobody really follows their own advice all the time, but they can give it. So that is it, you guys. That is my long video. 12th house Mercury, personal placement. So felt pretty confident in everything I said. If I missed anything or if you feel like I got anything wrong, you can leave it in the comments. Please subscribe, please share, and please like the video. And there'll be more to come.